Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the auditorium of Northside Baptist Church today. I know the weather's kind of bad on the outside, but it's good here on the inside. And it's good to see you. We welcome every one of you. May the good Lord bless you. And you out in the radio listening audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour. That's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking, and we're hoping during this hour coming up, we can be a real inspiration to everyone. Take your Bible now and turn to the book of Ruth, would you please? We'll continue on today in the great book of Ruth. We're in chapter 4 today. Now, this will be tape number 10 on the book of Ruth. Tape number 10. We have 10 tapes on the book of Ruth so far. And this will be tape number 271. If you'd like to have a list of our tape, we have 266 listed. But this will be tape number 271. If you want to write in and get these tapes, why, we'd glad for you to do so. They're $3 each. And then the gift is used to help defray our radio expense. Now, you pray for me and write to me next week. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. Even right now, you can get work. Now, the book of Ruth, chapter 4. There's a man and his wife walking along the road one day, and she thought she was coming to the end of life's journey. And she was telling her husband certain things that she wanted him to do after her death and what not to do. And she said to him, she said, "Now listen, by all means, I want you to marry again. If you do marry again, be sure that your next wife do not wear any of my clothes." Why, he said, "Honey, don't worry about that." He said, "Those clothes won't fit Jane anyway." All right. Ruth chapter 4, we'll begin reading with chapter 1 and read a few verses. Now in the book of Ruth, let me tell you about this. In the book of Ruth, you find the book of Ruth to be book number 8, a book of new beginnings. And then you have 4 chapters, you have 85 verses, you have 2,578 words. You have 16 questions, you have 30 commands, and you have 2 promises in the book of Ruth. What a wonderful book you find in the Word of God. One of the greatest love stories you find in God's wonderful book. Now in chapter 4, we find that Boaz is getting busy now because something very important is about to happen. We saw in chapter 3 where that, of course, Ruth went down to the threshing floor. And they made plans about a wedding to take place later on and for him to redeem back the property that Elimelech and Naomi had lost when they left Bethlehem, Judah, and gone down into Moab. Now he gets in a hurry. We'll tell you in a few moments why he is kind of in a hurry about this. Let's read a few verses first of all. "Then went Boaz up to the gate and set him down there. And behold, the kinsman of whom Boaz spake came by, unto whom he said, 'Ho, such a one, turn aside, sit down here.' And he turned aside and sat down. And he took 10 men of the elders of the city and said, 'Sit you down here.' And they sat down. And he said unto the kinsman, Naomi, that is come again out of the country of Moab, selleth a parcel of land which was our brother Elimelech's. And I thought to advertise thee, saying, buy it before the inhabitants and before the elders of my people. If thou will redeem it, redeem it. But if thou will not redeem it, then tell me that I may know, for there's none to redeem it beside thee, and I am after thee.' And he said, 'I will redeem it.' Then said Boaz, 'What day thou buyest the field of the hand of Naomi, thou must buy it also of Ruth the Moabitess, the wife of the dead, to raise up the name of the dead upon his inheritance.' And the kinsman said, 'I cannot redeem it for myself, lest I mar my own inheritance. Redeem thou my right to thyself, for I cannot redeem it.' Now, if you notice here that Boaz is talking to the near kinsman, they had discussed this matter of redeeming the property and, of course, marrying Ruth. And now they found out there was a near kinsman, one that could, first of all, buy the land back and also marry Ruth if he desired. Now, that had to be taken care of. And so when Boaz goes up to the gate of the city where they transact all business did in those days, and chose the 10 elders, which is a type of the 10 commandments. And then we find that this near kinsman comes by, and he's the type of the flesh of the Adamic nature, as we see later on as we move through this great chapter. But we find here in chapters 1 and 2, we find grace sought. In chapter 3, we find rest sought after. In chapter 4, we find glorification. Now, you must keep that in mind. But somebody could buy this land back. In Old Testament days, if people had to pawn or lose their property, then it could be bought back. If it could not be bought back within 50 years, at the end of the 50 years, on the 50th year, it could be turned back to the original owner. That was the year of Jubilee. But if somebody bought the land back, if they would pay for the redeeming price, then they could buy the land back. Now, we do know then that Naomi and Elimelech had been down in Moab for about 10 years. Now, there must be a period of time to take care of that, some 40 years. It must be paid off in order for them to get the land back. And the only person could do that had to be the nearest kin, a brother, a close relative, or someone of the nearest kin. And so we find that Boaz and Ruth is talking about this, and all of a sudden they discover that there is a near kinsman. Verses chapter 2 and verse 1, Naomi had a kinsman of her husband, a mighty man of wealth, of the family of Elimelech. His name was Boaz, but there's one a little closer kin than that. Now Boaz had to solve this matter, he had to take care of this, and he sits this man down here before the 10 elders and the people that assemble there at the gate to transact this business. Now, there's a reason for this man, Boaz, getting in a hurry. I think the reason is not because she was so beautiful, not because she was such a fine-looking person in that respect, but she was a virtuous woman. The Bible tells us that the news had gotten out all over the village there in Bethlehem that she was a fine, virtuous woman, a good woman, an industrious woman, a woman that would make any man a good wife. And so he knew that. It didn't matter so much to him about how pretty she was, but she may have been pretty. I surmise that she was. But he knew that she had a good reputation. She'd make a man a good wife. Now, when people are selecting a wife, young people, you need to take that in consideration. Beauty is not everything. Somebody said beauty is only skin deep. Will that girl make you a good wife? Would she be a good mother? Would she be a good housekeeper? Would she be able to care for your children if you had children? What kind of wife would she be? Now, a lot of people today, the young people, they get in a hurry. They think they're in love. They see somebody and they say, well, I love that person. And they don't know the difference between love and lust. And a lot of people marry for lust. And then later on, they find that they're not so happy. That's something you need to weigh out before you marry any person. You must marry a good person, if you're a good person yourself. And then not only marry just for looks. Now, of course, you want somebody that looks nice and well. And if you're marrying a young girl, you want it to be beautiful, of course. But that's not all that counts. You must wonder, what kind of wife would she be? Would she be a real good housekeeper? Is she a real lazy person? Does she want to get about all the time and instead of being a good keeper at home? What kind of parents does she have? If you want to kind of know what your wife will look like when she gets old, then you look at her parents if they're up in years, and you can kind of judge as to kind of what she will look like when she grows older. Now, take all of these things in consideration, but that doesn't amount to very much if her parents are good people, a mother is a good woman, and a good housekeeper and a good wife to her husband, that goes a long way. And if the husband is a good man, good to his wife, loves his wife, provides for his wife, you need to take all of that in consideration. Now I want to say this to young people. Today we're living in a day when a lot of looseness going on among young people. One of the greatest things you can offer that husband to be or that wife to be is a virtuous person, your virginity. Now a lot of people today, they think, well, if I don't lose my virginity, then I'm not with the crowd. Anybody, just any person, any young person can go out here and lose their virginity. And of course, that's a reflection on them. The greatest people, the greatest young people alive today, and those that have the greatest character, and those that make the greatest wives or the greatest husbands, are those that are virgins. Now you better remember that. It takes a real young person, whether boy or girl, to remain a true virgin until they get married. That's the greatest thing in the world that you can offer to the person that you married. Now, if you throw yourself away and you go out and carouse around and lay up with boys and girls while you're young, what kind of proof you're not going to do that after you get married? A person that's a virgin, as a general rule, if they remain that way, if they have character, if they mean business and stay clean and pure and holy, and they're virgins when they get married, then they'll probably remain that way throughout their marriage life. Now you must keep that in mind. And young people need to consider that. Now this wild, rowdiest crowd today, you may feel like, well, I'm an oddball. If I'm a virgin, I'm an oddball. No, you're a real person. You got character. You got what it takes to make a great person, a great husband, a great wife, a great American. You ought to be proud of that. That ought to be valuable, invaluable as far as you're concerned. Anybody can go out and drink beer and go to dances and move and picture shows and places of lust and live like the devil. Anybody can do that. Just any young people can do that. But it takes a real person, a real young girl, and a real young boy to say, no, I am not going out here and live a wild, riotous life. People like that are gems. People like that have character. People like that are great. They're priceless in this age in which we live. Remember this, anybody can throw themselves away. Anybody can go out here and live in lust and live like them. Anybody can do that. It takes a great, great person not to bow or compromise and give up and live in lust out here with this world because everybody else is doing it. Lay off of these things of the world. A lot of young girls and boys get out and start smoking pot and taking dope and hash or whatever you call it. And the first thing you know, they're hooked on it and their health is ruined. Their mind is affected, and they throw their lives away and go to a premature grave. Lay off and be a total abstainer. Don't drink beer. Don't drink alcohol. Don't smoke. Don't smoke pot or anything like that. Live a clean, holy life and be somebody. Anybody can throw themselves away, but it takes a great person to be somebody. And you're living in a day whenever the time has come, the challenge has never been greater than right now for young people to determine they're going to be respectable and they're going to be somebody as they grow older. Now it takes a person, this character, to do that. It certainly does. And we find here that this man Boaz knew that this woman was a virtuous woman among the people that lived there in the village. And that's why he was in such a big hurry to get down and marry this woman. They didn't come in bunches like bananas. And good girls today and good boys today don't come in bunches like bananas. You can rest assured of that. When you find a good one, a virtuous one, you better hold on to that person if you possibly can. There are few and far between. So he got into a big hurry and he went down to get this business taken care of. And he had to go down and he met this man down there that was nearer kin than he. And he had to get that matter out of the way. Now you'll find back in the Old Testament what the scripture is pertaining to the matter of redeeming so and so forth. In Leviticus chapter 25, verses 25 through 28 tells you about that. And then if you read that scripture, if you read Deuteronomy chapter 25 and verse 5, it tells you about the matter of redeeming. In Old Testament days, if a man had to sell himself out as a slave, then he could be bought back out of the market. That is, somebody of near kin could redeem him, could pay the price and redeem him. If not, after the time of Jubilee arrives, that is the 50-year period, then he could go back to his original owner. If a person in the Old Testament, man and his wife, for instance, like Naomi and Elimelech, if they lost their property. Now, this couple had property in Bethlehem, but for some reason or other, they decided to leave that and go down into Moab, a cursed land. And so when they pawned their property and left it, then, of course, they couldn't get that property back within 50 years. They had to wait 50 years before they could even think about getting it back. And so they stayed down there about 9 or 10 years and came back. Now the man that could buy that land back had to be, of course, of the near kin. And so this man Boaz found out a man a little closer kin than he was. And he went to him and asked him, would he buy the land back? And the man said, yeah, I'll buy the land back. I'll be glad to. But he said, no, wait a minute. There's one hitch. If you buy that land back, according to Mrs. Naomi, you got to marry Ruth. Now, Naomi had something else in mind. She's the type of Israel. Ruth is the type of the church. And Naomi had already settled that in her mind. The person that redeemed their property back had to redeem Ruth, had to marry Ruth. And so he said to this near kinsman, he said, all right, you can buy the land back, but you got to marry Ruth. Oh, he said, wait a minute. He said, just stop right there. He said, I'll buy the land back, but I won't marry Ruth the Moabitess. Maybe he kind of looked down on her because she came out of the land of Moab. She's a Moabitess. She came out of a cursed land and a bad background. I bet it's her people were. And so he looked down on her. Maybe he said, now wait a minute. If I marry this girl Ruth, this widow here, then of course she's a Moabitess woman. And he probably already had one wife or more and probably had children. And he said, if I marry her and bring her into the family, and then one of these days when I die, then she'll get part of my property. She'll mar my inheritance. And she's going to cause trouble in my family. And he said, I just can't do it. It'll mar my own inheritance. See, he was concerned about himself. It will mar my own inheritance. When he looked at that girl, he said, no, if I bring her into my family, that will mar my own inheritance. He was thinking only of self. He wasn't thinking about Naomi getting her land back for him. He wasn't thinking about this woman becoming a beautiful bride. He wasn't thinking about that. He wasn't thinking about building up Marlon's lifeline that a Savior might come through him, that he might remain alive on the earth as far as his descendants are concerned. He wasn't concerned about that. He said, my own inheritance. Me, my. He was concerned about himself. And we're living in a selfish age today when everybody seems to be concerned about themselves, and that's all. Just about themselves. And so he said, no, just pass me up. Now in those days, according to scripture in the Old Testament, they had to take a man had to take his shoe off and hand it to the other person that redeemed it. And when he refused to buy back the land, so he took his shoe off and handed it to Boaz. And in the Old Testament, then the person in whose the land belonged to had a perfect right to walk up and spit in his face. In other words, the Old Testament said, if a man dies, leaves a wife, and he's got a brother, and his brother won't buy his property, won't marry his widow, then he has to take his shoe off, and then this widow can walk up, and they're spit in his face. Now, that's exactly why they spit in the face of Jesus. When Jesus came to the earth, they thought it was he that would redeem Israel. They said he's our elder brother, and he should redeem Israel. And when Jesus refused to redeem Israel, they walked up and spit in his face. Now, beloved, listen to me. This man Boaz was left in a position then that he might go ahead and transact the business, redeem the land, turn it back to Naomi, and marry Ruth, and that he did. And so this other man, the near kinsman, walked away, turned his back on the situation, and went on his way. Now we find here that these 10 elders sitting at the gate represents the 10 commandments. We find that this near kinsman represents the Adamic nature of the human race apart from God, the old man, so to speak. And of course, all of this had to be redeemed. And so we find that this man Boaz is willing to redeem the land and willing to marry Ruth. Now, this matter of redemption is very precious. That's exactly what Jesus did for us. Now, when Adam and Eve left the Garden of Eden, they were expelled from the garden, and they left that beautiful garden. And then when they sinned against God before they were turned out of the garden, then, of course, they lost all their righteous standing before God. And then God put a curse upon the earth. Now, God created Adam and placed him in the garden, he and Eve, in order to take care of the garden. And the earth was without a curse. But when they sinned against God, then they lost their righteous standing before God. And that was a curse set down upon the earth. And the whole world was brought under a curse, all because of Adam's sin. Now we find, according to the Bible, there's one that came on the scene that could buy all of that back. Now the law couldn't do it. The Ten Commandments couldn't get it back. And neither could the Adamic nature get it back. A type of the near kinsman, a type of the ten elders here. They could not buy back what Adam and Eve lost in the garden. But there came a near kinsman, our elder brother, a man born of the nation of Israel, born of the Virgin Mary, whose name was Jesus. He was the only person living that could buy back what Adam lost in the garden. The Bible says we're redeemed with the precious blood of Jesus as a lamb without spot and without blemish. And Jesus was the only one that could come and die on a cross and shed his blood. And through that shed blood, he could buy back everything that Adam lost. And Jesus bought that back. One of these days, they're going to be a curse lifted from the earth. It will be lifted. Jesus already paid for it. During the millennium, the curse will be lifted. Jesus bought our souls. When we sin in the Garden of Eden, in Adam, when he sinned, we all sinned in him. And we are born sinners. We are born lost and without God. That is, as far as the sin is concerned, we are saved till we get the age of accountability. And then we have to be born in the family of God. But we lost our righteous standing in Adam. But when Jesus came, our near kinsman, and bought paid for the sin debt on Calvary with his own precious blood, that meant he bought us back to himself. Adam led us away from God. Jesus brings us back to God. Now, when Jesus paid that sin debt with his own precious blood, that means that when you repent and trust him as your Savior, then you have already kept the Ten Commandments in Christ. He kept them for you. Now, the Ten Commandments couldn't do that. If people tried to keep the Ten Commandments, they broke them. They couldn't keep them. Though they had, that would have not have taken care of the price to be paid. And the near kinsman came, the Lord Jesus Christ, to do something about that. Now, trying to live a good moral life and the ceremonial laws could not bring that back to the human race. They had all kind of ceremonial laws in the Old Testament. They had the offering of lambs and sacrifices and so forth. But that couldn't bring us back where God wanted us in Christ Jesus. He had to come and pay that sin debt. And he came and died on the cross. And when he did, he bought my soul. He bought your soul. And when we trusted Christ our Savior, then we were redeemed by his precious blood. We are saved and safe and secure for heaven. But wait a minute. There's something else that's to be redeemed yet, and that's the body. That'll be redeemed. It's already paid for, but it'll be changed when you get your new body. But that's not all. There's something else that's been paid for on Calvary that's not been delivered yet. And that is the curse upon this earth. The curse upon this earth is here because of Adam and Eve's sin in the garden. And Jesus, at the end of the tribulation period, when he comes back to set up his kingdom upon the earth, He is going to deliver the curse from this earth. And during the millennium, this earth is going to be somewhat like the Garden of Eden. There won't be any curse on the earth during the millennium. There won't be any briars and thorns to stick you with, and pests destroy your fruit and things to destroy the vineyards and so forth. All the curse of the land will be delivered. The curse will be delivered from the land. And then the land will be somewhat like the Garden of Eden. But that won't take place until Jesus comes back to set up his kingdom. It's already paid for. Jesus paid the sin debt from Adam to the end of the millennium. Jesus paid all of your past sins, your present sins, and your future sins. He paid for all of them. Jesus paid for everything that was lost in Adam. The redemption of the body, the glorifying of the body, and the curse been lifted from the earth. Jesus paid for that on Calvary. He paid for everything. The old song says, all to him we owe. Sin left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Jesus paid the price. Some of you heard me tell the story about the little boy that fixed himself up a nice little boat, very beautiful, and he took great pains and had a beautiful little boat, and he went down to the riverbank in order to float it in the water. And one day the thing got away from him and went down the river. Oh, it grieved his little heart. He couldn't find his little boat. He cried, and he wanted his little boat so badly. And so one day he was down the river a few miles, and he was coming up a little village street there, and he came by a pawn shop, and he saw his little boat there in that pawn shop. He recognized it. Oh, he said, that's my boat. That's my boat there. And he went in, he said to the broker, he said, sir, said, that's my boat. I made that boat. It's mine. Oh, he said, I'm sorry, son. A man came in here the other day and pawned me that boat. That's my boat. You have to pay the price to get that boat. He said, sir, what would I have to pay? He told him. He said, you just hold it now till I get back. He went back home. He saved every nickel he could get his hands on. He saved up enough money to buy that boat back. He went down there, walked in. He said, Mr. Broker, I have the money, sir. And he pulled out the money, and the man gave him the boat. And he put it in his arms. He started up the street, and he hugged that boat to his bosom. And he said, boat, I love you so much. Said, you're twice mine. Said, I created you. I made you. You were my boat. And then you got away from me, and now I bought you back again. You're twice mine. Oh, how I appreciate you so very much. That's exactly what Jesus did. Jesus Christ created human beings upon the earth, created mankind. They belonged to him. He created them. And then mankind got away from Jesus. We fell in Adam. And Jesus came back to the cross and bought us back again with his precious blood. Now we're twice his, and God loves his children. We're God's by creation, and we're God's by redemption. I'm talking now about the saved people. They're God's by creation, and they're God's by redemption. You have been bought with the precious blood of Jesus. You're not your own. The Bible says you're bought with a price. That body of yours belongs to God. You belong to the Lord. You're not your own anymore. You can't say, I'll do what I want to do, if I don't like it, I won't do it. No, you belong to God. You better take God in consideration. Is the Lord pleased about this? God said, you're mine. I bought you with my precious blood. And if you're here today and you've never been saved, you ought to get saved. If you're listening out in the radio listening audience, you've never been saved, you ought to get saved right now. It's appointed a man once to die, and after that, the judgment. Behold, today is the day of salvation. Behold, now is accepted time. And if I were you, I'd come to Jesus right now. I wouldn't wait another minute. I hope somebody in the radio listeners right now will accept Christ. I trust somebody in this building will do business with God. I appreciate the way you've listened. You've listened well. Let's stand to our feet. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray today that you'll use the message. Thank you for redemptive price paid by our precious Savior, the shed blood of the Lamb. God, help us realize we're not our own. We are bought with a price. Now, Father, I pray that you'll have your way here this morning. Speak to hearts. May Jesus be honored. Use the message and bless every heart in this building. Everyone in the radio listening audience that loves you, I pray that you'll bless them. In Christ's name, amen. Now, Debbie's going to play for us on the organ here a verse or so. and why she's doing so. If you're in this building and you're not saved, come down here and get right with God. If you're in this building, you're backslidden on God, come back to the Lord. If you're in this building, you want to join this church and make Northside your church home, become a member of this church, come on down here. We'll take that in consideration. If any other reason God is speaking to you here today, just come forward and let us help you. While she plays, we're waiting on you. Would you come? Would you come while we wait? Speaking, you obey it. That's all I ask you to do. I've done what God asked me to do, and that's up to you.